Are genetically modified organisms a technological solution to food security, or just a risky food option with unknown long-term consequences? The use and consumption of GMOs have long been a controversial issue, especially among health buffs and environmentalists. Now, last month, the Court of Appeals granted a writ of kalikasan, stopping the field trials of genetically engineered BT eggplants. While environmental watchdog Greenpeace lauds that ruling, it says the government needs to review its protocols as well as safety concerns about GMOs. The group says so far there are about 62 kinds of GMOs within imported food products that are made available to Filipino consumers, and these are unlabeled food products. While 8 kinds of GMOs are allowed to be planted on Philippine soil, all without any certainty that they are safe for the environment, let alone for human consumption. For our discussion tonight, we're joined here in the studio by Greenpeace Southeast Asia political advisor, attorney Zelda Soriano. You can join our discussion by sending us your comments and questions through Twitter using the hashtag Primetime, or post them on our Facebook page. That's ANC247. Attorney Soriano, thanks for joining us and good evening to you.
Good evening.
All right, this whole issue about genetically modified organisms or GMOs. Last week, Court of Appeals handed down that specific ruling, as I said, extending that writ of kalikasan,
yes,
against a trial of field trials for the BT eggplants.
Right.
Now, mainstream media picked up the story about 2 or 3 days after that decision was handed down. Could this issue be more of a mainstream one, so that people will really understand the issue of GMOs in this country?
Well, it should be. It should be a mainstream issue because of the public policy relevance of BT law. Its impacts are far-reaching and cover social, economic, and even cultural issues. So that is why it should be a mainstream issue.
Why do you think it's not, and it hasn't been? Because when I look back, it's been more than a decade probably when the first article probably was written about this, or the first concern was really announced regarding this particular issue. Not entirely here in the Philippines, of course, but in other parts of the globe, there was really concern already.
Well, basically, as you may have also noticed, BT talong is something of a mix of science and technology and all the public policy issues that I've mentioned earlier. Mm. So it's a challenge to communicate it publicly. Mm. Aside from that, the process of regulation from application of GM crops to the approval process, up to field testing, monitoring during field tests, all these steps are more confined within the Department of Agriculture, specifically the claimed regulatory body, the Institute of Plant Breeding. Mm-hmm.
Pero sayang, no? I wish, you know, consumers would be really...
Sorry, Bureau of Plant and Industry.
Yeah, the consumers would really be engaged in this whole issue, because it's not just an issue for the Department of Agriculture or the merchandisers or the farmers.
Well,
because at the end
true.
Of the day, we consume it.
Yeah, that's true. And it is a very widely available vegetable in the Philippines, and most Filipinos consume eggplant on everyday basis. So that is why it is very important for the common people to understand what is happening with our traditional eggplant variety.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about that before the writ of kalikasan was handed down. What could have been the dangers had this had the field trials just gone on unnoticed?
Well, basically, the BT eggplant should have been an ordinary traditional eggplant until a gene from a soil bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis was inserted to that traditional eggplant. Mm. The purpose of the insertion is for that gene from the soil bacterium to be part of the natural makeup of our traditional eggplant.
Mm-mm.
So it produces, the process of insertion produces a novel form of eggplant organism. Now, the
Which is resistant. Which is resistant to what? Pests.
It is supposed to carry insecticidal properties, targeting a major predator of eggplant called the fruit and shoot borer, and all other insects that would predate on the eggplant. And the technology that made that process possible is called genetic engineering. That is why we call it usually genetically modified eggplant.
And the danger to that, as a consumer, explain that to us. So if you have this testing being done on something like, in this particular case, an eggplant, what would happen to a consumer if he ingests the eggplant with a genetically modified organism?
Firstly, the science behind the BT talong. And the BT talong, as a product, as a living product of that genetic engineering technology, is being debated upon globally as unsafe, and there is yet no scientific consensus as to its safety and impacts both to human health and to the environment. So that once the BT talong was removed from the laboratory and planted in an open farm, then that is a very different story from because a simple experiment inside a laboratory.
Right, because then the organism or whatever was done to the eggplant might just seep into the ground and we don't know how far it can reach.
Or the pollens may just be blown out.
Or into the watershed.
Outside, so or by human error, accident, for example. There could be contamination of relative eggplants or other plants and animals.
Now here's the argument of the other side. It's all about food security, they say. The GMO would be able, GMOs rather, would be able to help solve the problem of insufficient food all over the world. It helps the yield. It helps the farmers to produce more yields in terms of crops that are resistant to pests and whatever it is that affect their harvest. What do you say to that? And what's your counter argument? What's the alternative?
Well, it's a highly debatable claim, actually. And I wish food security is as simple as that. Because by food security, it means ensuring the availability, accessibility of nutritious, adequate, and diverse food at an affordable rates and accessible when wanted or when needed by the people. So it's beyond BT talong, the availability of BT talong. In fact, more emphasis I would give to the necessity for diversity of vegetables, of food on the table of Filipinos. So that justification for food security will actually fall apart when BT talong is considered in the context of the scientific uncertainties now haunting this BT eggplant. The other thing is that even before the BT eggplant introduction in the Philippines and up to now, I do not know that there is a crisis in the supply of eggplant in the Philippines. In fact, it is the most readily available eggplant and very much affordable.
So to your mind, Attorney Soriano, what would be the reason for these testings? And what would be the primary argument for these people who would want genetically modified organisms built into certain crops? Why are they doing it?
Let me answer that in two ways. Basically, it will lead us, or a prudent mind is to be led to an appreciation of that fact as something business motivated or profit,
so it's profit.
Motivated. Because who is to gain from the introduction of BT eggplant? Who has the patent of the gene inserted in the eggplant? And a patent is an exercise of ownership. So what does it mean after its introduction? Mm-hmm. It must be business oriented, profit driven. Mm-hmm. The other way of answering that is in the experience of India, where this BT eggplant has actually been the source or the origin of both the technology and at the same time the crop. In India, it is called BT Brinjal. Mm. It is the equivalent of BT Talong mm-hmm. in the Philippines. And in 2010, similar circumstances, it was introduced, field tested, and being pushed for commercial propagation after the field testing. Mm. But for the same reason of scientific uncertainties as to its safety and impacts to the environment, the Ministry of Environment and Forestry in India declared a ban on the commercial introduction of BT Brinjal in India.
So they found another way to the Philippines this time.
And it's just like a month after, a very few months after the ban in India.
Mm. But how were our farmers or eggplant farmers doing before the introduction of the GMOs?
Well, that is basically what I'm saying earlier, that
you were okay,
I do not know of any crisis in the supply, and I do not know of any challenges as to the quality of our traditional eggplants. Mm. So there is no sense, actually, unless it is a business sense, to introduce BT Brinjal, or rather BT Talong in the Philippines.
Now, you say that there are certain flaws and lapses in the current regulatory process mm-hmm. concerning GMOs, the introduction of it here in the country. What are these?
Yes. Firstly, there is no, what you can say, as a mother law. There is no act from Congress that governs the introduction, study, regulation of genetically modified crops in agriculture.
Mm. But there should be.
There should be, yes, there should be. Dapat nuuna pa eh, before even the field testing of BT Talong and other genetically modified
because
crops.
Because make no mistake about it, this is not going to be the last time someone's going to try.
Right. Now, that is basically the problem. There is no law that governs GM crops usage in the Philippines. Second, the current rules, departmental rules that are being resorted to or referred to by current proponents of BT Talong, they are very inadequate and ineffective compared to the standards, the internationally accepted standards provided by, say, an international agreement, the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety. The provisions, the guidelines, and the prevailing practices are really highly questionable.
Now, in the absence of a mother law, as you call it, mm-hmm. that would basically put in place safeguards for us, for farmers, for our consumers as well, can we look at this writ of kalikasan to sort of warn those who may want to try because they know that there's a case study already? Can this probably be depended on as something that would prevent such a thing from happening again? Or we still need that law?
I would like to be optimistic and echo that opinion. It is a legal weapon, actually. It is a legal weapon, especially of the marginalized and the poor. You know, because the writ of kalikasan under the new rules of procedure for environmental cases have some unique features and characteristics that make it accessible as a defense, as a legal weapon for common citizens and even for non-governmental organizations like Greenpeace and the fellow petitioners of Greenpeace like Masipag, a former scientist group. So it is accessible by these groups for and in behalf of Filipino people who are whose rights to a balanced and healthful ecology mm-hmm. and to health are violated or threatened to be violated.
All right, just as a final question, just to wrap mm-hmm. things up before we go. You say that it is an environmental, health, and socio-economic issue. What makes this such?
Yeah, because you know, when the moment BT talong was removed from the confines of the laboratory and planted in the farm, then it is exposed to all forms of contamination. Now, what is the effect or consequence of contamination? You can say one, on the scientifically, I can say that is still debatable. One would say it's okay to have other varieties be contaminated because they will acquire positive traits. Mm. On the other hand, there is an equal amount of literature saying, no, it's very dangerous because the impacts may be irreversible. Mm. The hazards may be irreversible. Mm. For example, the ability of any form of pest and other living things to develop resistance. Mm. You know, kung paulit-ulit yung control that
right,
pest.
And that's the reason, Attorney Soriano, why a lot of people are saying that, you know, that's the reason why we have all these allergies, we have all these viruses, mm-hmm. super strains that we don't know where it came from. It's because of all these engineering that's been going on. But I'm sorry, we're going to have to let you go as we check on the international airport in Davao. We'd like to thank you for joining us, Attorney Zelda Soriano of Greenpeace, a political advisor in that particular group, an environmental group, watching over this particular issue regarding the BT talong. Thanks again for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Tonight.